The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to Jesus and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." The Gospel of the Lord.
It's easy to chastise James and John for their tone-deaf request of Jesus. Mark's Gospel portrays the disciples as always missing the point, somewhat clueless, even stubborn. But before we jump on the blame game bandwagon, let's take a step back, not just to see the proverbial log in our own eye, but a moment to take stock of what might be going on with these two followers that could be more than just another example of discipleship cluelessness. After the last 20 months, maybe there's a chance that we can look at this story a little differently. You know, our world has been turned upside down, right? And upside-downness results in, or at least it should, new ways of looking at our faith. Upside down life, then maybe what we need is an upside down faith. You see, James and John are not ill-informed, they're not ignorant. They've witnessed Jesus' miracles, they've listened to his teachings, and already by the time we get to this reading in Mark's Gospel, Jesus has predicted his suffering and death three times. They've been given hint after hint that following Jesus is likely not going to be what they expected, nor is it going to end where they want it to end. And yet, James and John are doing what humans do best. They're hoping and praying that the world has not and will not change as much as it already has and as much as they fear it might. But there is no return to what once was. For in Mark's Gospel, as the Tuesday morning Bible study group is aware of, at Jesus' baptism, the heavens are torn apart, a sign that the world will never be the same. Something new is breaking into the cosmos. And the reason for all that? Jesus has come to change everything. There will be no going back to life before the storm. But we try. And we have been trying, hoping and praying that the last 20 months are a mere blip in our lives and a minor speed bump along the ecclesial road in the development of a new church. We are more like James and John than we care to admit. We fall back on what we know, what's comfortable, how the world has always worked. For James and John, that meant glory as hierarchy and power as prestige. Whether we're willing to admit it or not, we spend much of our energy trying to return to a time before whatever happened that changed the course of our life, whether that be the diagnosis of a cancer, Parkinson's, dementia, whether it be a nasty divorce, the upheaval of democracy, security, or even a pandemic. But as hard as we try, we know we cannot go back. For the 21st century church, it's the same. The institutional church, declining as it is, constantly doubles down on things of the past that no longer work. Life has changed. The world has changed. people have changed. What once was is not working anymore. We know that. I mean, deep in our hearts and our souls, and if we were honest, we simply don't know how to fix it. Believe me, I understand. These have been the most exciting days for me, 31 years of pastoral ministry, to do this work out here in the desert of River Pope, but they've also been the most challenging, and I have to say the most frustrating. You see, you know me to be a relational pastor, and doing so much of church online is not what originally sparked my passion to become a pastor. Nonetheless, I understand it's important, it's necessary to do, but I feel like a beginner again, like my first year in ministry. You know, I'll let you in on a little secret. Most of the time, I have no idea what I'm doing. I know I can't do pastoral ministry the way I used to, because what it means to be a pastor is undergoing a seismic shift, and I don't know how to get it all to go back to what I knew and was comfortable with. I either resist the change and retire early, or I change with it and become a different pastor than the one I used to be. And it's even more global than that. For the demand of change is not just vocational, it's personal. The person I was before the last 20 months no longer works in the world. Do I dig in my heels? Do I curse the world for the crises that have changed it? Or do I open myself up to possibilities of becoming a new person, emerging into a world that is no longer what it used to be? You can't go through the past 20 months with a convergence of politics, a volatility of protests, and then a pandemic, and not have everything you do, everything you believed in, to be called into question. For living these days, and by living I mean parenting or grandparenting, managing relationships, caring for parents or spouses or partners, trying to care for ourselves, looking for joy, accompanying the suffering, crying out against injustices, starting a church. Why, that means living in the middle of trauma, individual, collective, global, in the midst of merging crises. We can hear this as depressing, demoralizing. The sky is falling as Henny Penny cries out in Chicken Little. Statistics are alarming in many categories. Much doesn't seem to be headed in the right direction. Even in this work that we do at River of Hope, as we deal with certain realities, there are concerns. We are living in a time of rapid cultural changes, and the imperative seems to be to figure it out, how to adapt, how to innovate, and we have the choice, recreate the life and the ministry that we've known. I see this as a time for reformation, if not of the church, then reformation of those within it. The call of the gospel is still valid. The need for people to hear the good news is desperately relevant. Healing is still needful, and chains of oppression still in need of breaking. And we are still alive, and we are still present in this world. Please tell me that we haven't given up on already on making a difference within it. I use the word crisis, but I don't mean the sky is falling kind of crisis, but crisis as a decisive and definitive moment, an acute moment for decision and discernment. It is this kind of moment for James and John, for all of the disciples, for you and me. It is no accident that the story of James and John grabbing at power, that it gets told when it does. Jesus is about to enter into Jerusalem, and what will happen there will change the course of the world forever. There will be no going back to life before the cross and the empty tomb. When we don't have answers, or there doesn't seem to be any answers in the immediate future, our human evasion is to partner with power rather than hold hands with humility. That's what James and John tried to do in the gospel lesson. But maybe this is the time, or at least this is the moment, to remember that the Spirit of God is present. It would be that same Spirit who would be present with Jesus in the wilderness, on the cross, and in that cold, dark, and seemingly hopeless tomb. And it is that same Spirit who is in and among us, with us and beside us, calling us to repentance. And remember, repentance is simply a change of heart, a change of direction, to change our perspective, to see what can be instead of what just was, to trust that the kingdom of God has come near, and it continues to come near even in days and times like this, to see in an upside-down world that life calls for an upside-down faith. It is that same Spirit who is inspiring God's church here at River of Hope to once again gather, love, and serve, and to redefine what we mean by those words, so that we not only say them, but that we become the very embodiment of them. Let's do more than simply believe the good news. Let's become the good news, even as we become more and more the church that God has already made us to be. Amen.